Hey, Blues fans, this is Anthony. It's Free Lesson Friday, or today, I guess it's kind of Philosophy Friday. I'm going to talk to you for a little bit about the subject of originality and some things that I've realized about myself. This pandemic has been an extended time where I've had more time than I'd like to think about myself and my own playing, and I've realized a couple things that I think will be helpful to some of you and maybe interesting to more of you. So I'm going to talk today about the subject of originality and wanting to play like Stevie Ray Vaughan, and how I think that my own motivations for playing have shifted or evolved or grown, depending on how you want to look at it. So the basic gist of it is this. I think that I am done trying to sound more like Stevie Ray Vaughan, with the emphasis on the word more. And I'm going to attempt to clarify what I mean by that. So over the past however many years I've been playing, I started when I was 18 and I'm 45 now. My first influence was actually not Stevie Ray Vaughan. It was like Slash and Led Zeppelin. But the first player that made me feel like I needed to play was Stevie Ray Vaughan. And when I started learning his style, I was in college. I was in some ways lonely because I did not have any kind of social life. I was obsessed with guitar. I didn't party. I didn't drink. I didn't do anything like that. And I know now that I was beginning to struggle regularly with anxiety and depression. And so the playing of Stevie Ray Vaughan and his music offered me a way to act on the depression that I was feeling in a way that words could not accomplish. There was nothing that I could say and nobody that I could say it to that would give me the release that playing guitar did. And the only person who I listened to whose playing allowed me to have that release was Stevie Ray Vaughan. So when I tell people that I learned to play his style, it's not just because I wanted to, it really felt like I needed to. Like I didn't have a choice. It was the only thing that allowed me to get through college without losing my mind. And so for me, Stevie's playing has always been something where I would hear him play it, and even though it was coming from his record, it felt like the notes were coming out of me when I'd listen to him play. It was just distinctly different between him and everyone else. And yes, I loved Albert King, and yes, I loved Jimi Hendrix, and there are elements in both of their playing and some other people I listened to who at times would make me feel the same way, but nobody's playing allowed me to express on a more consistent basis what I was feeling than trying to play like Stevie Ray Vaughan. And so over the first 10 years that I was playing, my primary motivation was not to sound like Stevie Ray for the sake of sounding like him or to impress anybody. It was because it was an escape for me. And the more I was able to play like him, the more relief I felt. And so it was intensely personal for me. And I did not experience any negative pushback for that passion until I got out of college. And at this point, it was in 99, and the internet was just starting to become a more social place. For some of you kids, you've never had life without the internet, but when I went to college, I had never had email before. I had never been on a bulletin board or what they call forums now. I had never been on any of that stuff. And so I was in my own little bubble. I didn't interact with other guitar players. I didn't take lessons. I was in my own little world, finding an escape through Stevie Ray Vaughan's playing. And then I get out of college and I start interacting with people anymore, a little bit more. And there was a guitar player in town who was a more traditional style blues guitarist. And he was much older than me. And I looked up to him. But the more I got to know him and the more that he saw, because he met me when I was just getting into blues. So at that point, he didn't really know what I was about. And so over the next 4 years, as my style took on a distinctly Stevie Ray Vaughan tinge, I realized he does not like that I play like that. And I just kind of chalked it up to him being jealous or a bitter old man or whatever. And it, I'm not going to lie, it messed me up a little bit that somebody that had been one of my earliest local influences as blues guitar, like I never studied his playing or wanted to play like him, but he was doing what I hoped to do someday. And to find out that a person like that looks down on you because you want to play like Stevie Ray Vaughan, it kind of messes with you a little bit. Now, what I know now that I didn't know then is that he had been an active touring guitar player in the aftermath of Stevie Ray Vaughan's death. And if you look at music at that period, Stevie Ray Vaughan was just peaking in his popularity when he passed away, and he left this huge void in the blues world, and not just the blues world, but he was coming into the mainstream a little bit, is bringing blues a little bit into markets where they hadn't been. And then he's gone, and there was kind of like this land rush of mostly labels trying to fill that void with whoever could, you know, look or sound like Stevie Ray Vaughan. And what happened is that all across the country, there were guys popping up who thought they were going to be the next Stevie Ray Vaughan. So I started playing around 95, but there had been 5 years already of guitar players all over the country learning to play like Stevie Ray Vaughan, thinking they're going to be the next Stevie Ray Vaughan. The labels were happy to put that label on Ian Moore and whoever else they could find. And so this guy, this local guy, had been out touring during all this with his band up and down the East Coast. And he told me at one point later, it was like every town they got to, there was another hotshot guitar player who thought he was the next Stevie Ray Vaughan. He might have some speed, but his musical knowledge was really underdeveloped, and he thought he was the hot stuff, and he had to put up with this every single night, like another local guitar player trying to show him up, even though he's the featured act or whatever. And so it had kind of, it obviously had jaded him to the whole Stevie Ray Vaughan thing. He's the one that taught me the phrase cat in a hat with a Strat and Stevie Ray Vaughan-a-be. And on one hand, I can understand why he felt that way, but on the other hand, I was just a kid. Like I just told you, I'm just trying to survive. I am playing this way because I feel like I have to. Like, it is the only relief I find from my own mind. It's the only outlet I have for this thing inside of me that is making me feel this way that I don't understand. And so once I learned that he had that negative view of me, there's a thing about my personality where I do not like being told what to do. I guess I have a little bit of a problem with authority. I don't like being told, you can't do that, you shouldn't do that. And when I started to encounter that negative pushback against this, the fact that I sounded like Stevie Ray Vaughan was essentially kind of offensive to him. And And then as I got more on the internet, I started realizing, oh, wow, this is not just him. Like, there is a whole world of blues guitarists who look down on people who try and play like Stevie Ray Vaughan. I understand now it's because that had been done to death already by the late 90s. And it was like now there was like a second or maybe even third wave of young guitarists discovering Stevie and learning to him. So it's like finding out that there was this negative connotation had the opposite effect on me that it has had on certain other people. Certain other people feel that negativity and they change up their style because they don't want that negativity. For me, it hardened it. And I was determined I'm going to sound exactly like him. And so my motivations shifted a little bit at that point, where it was also that same desperation that I felt real early on, but now it was combined with a little bit of defiance. Like, I think you're a dinosaur because you don't like how I play, and so I'm going to do it so well it's going to make you sick. And I wasn't really consciously aware that that's what's happening. I can see that now in retrospect. But at the time, it just felt like this is an identity now. And I never saw it as, like, for me, it was never about being in a tribute band or wanting to dress like him or anything like that. For me, it was purely in the playing. Like, I never had any desire to emulate him as a person, just in my playing. And trust me, I don't fault people who do. I don't fault people who do tribute bands. I don't fault anybody for living however they want to live in regards to their musical idols. That's none of my business. It's just I couldn't do it because it wasn't honest for me. My interest in playing like Stevie Ray Vaughan was always 100% honest. And 100%, this is what I wanted to do. I never did it for other people. I never did it for because I thought that would what would get me the most attention. So my original instincts were 100% pure. This is what I needed to do. But over time, as I became more aware of what kind of attention guitar players could get, my desire to be that guitar slinger type kind of evolved with it. And I saw myself as this guitar slinger that was impressive. And this is pre-YouTube, okay? I want to make that very clear because I thought at all points in my playing, I thought that I was way better than I actually was. And this includes after I got out of college and had some nice tricks under my belt. I was never as good as I thought I was, but I didn't have anything to compare it to. And if I had seen, you know, the first thing that happened to me that was kind of devastating was I heard Kenny Wayne Shepherd on the radio in 99 or 2000. And it shattered my illusion because here was this kid who was younger than me who, at the time, I thought that we were as good as each other. I realize now I was nowhere near as good as he was, nowhere near as polished, but I couldn't hear it. All I know is here's this other person who could easily be the next Stevie Ray Vaughan, and I was insanely jealous. And once I got past that, I learned a bunch of stuff from him. But I was largely clueless about how many people there were out there that could play like this. And I was also clueless about just how basic playing like Stevie Ray Vaughan is in the grand scheme of the guitar world. I don't mean it's easy, but there are so many styles of guitar playing that are so much more complicated and require so much more technical skill. Playing like Stevie might require more physical strength and a different kind of endurance than other playing, but I was just clueless. I thought playing like Stevie Ray Vaughan was the hardest thing in the world, and since I could do it, I must be one of the best guitar players in the world. Like, I'm talking, like, really delusional. So my pure intentions when I started had kind of evolved into this belief that I was one of the best guitar players alive. And I don't think I really started figuring out that that wasn't the case until after I started Stevie Snacks in 2007. So I go through about 10 years of being in different bands and having them go nowhere. And finally arriving at the point where I realized, you know what? I'm a computer programmer. I'm happy with my life. I can just be a weekend warrior. And so I was finally ready to give up on the dream of being a touring guitar slinger hotshot. And I was happy just to live my life. And then I start putting lessons online, teaching the only thing I really knew how to do, which was Stevie Ray Vaughan. And then all of a sudden, I start getting way more attention than I ever expected. For my ability to play like him and to teach that style. And it kind of started feeding that ego again, not in terms of me thinking I'm good, but in terms of me feeling like this is my identity to do this. And so the first however many years of running Stevie Snacks, playing like Stevie Ray Vaughan was something that I kind of identified with more because now it was my job. And to some extent, the more I could play like him, the more it would make my career better and my business better. And I don't know exactly when that started to change, but somewhere between, I'd say, 2012 and 2014 or 15, I reached, like I, during his first however many years of Stevie Snacks, I definitely got better as a player, but I got way better in terms of my hearing. And a couple things were happening simultaneously. YouTube grew a lot, and along with that, I became aware of players like Tommy Katona, Philip Sace, people who took the Stevie Ray Vaughan style and mimicked it and internalized it far more accurately than I had, who had more technical skill than I did. And at first it was intimidating for me because I really felt like my whole business depended on me being the best at sounding like Stevie Ray Vaughan. So as I'm building this business and I'm realizing there's these other people who do this better than I do, it created a little bit of urgency in me to feel like I need to buckle down and I need to close some of these loopholes in terms of what I can play and what I can't. And so that resulted in me being able to distinguish more about habits that I had built that weren't really part of Stevie's playing. And so I could tell more now about where my style had kind of diverged from his a little bit. And so for a while, I made an attempt to really sound more like him. But then at some point, probably 2015, 2016, I kind of, I don't want to say I stopped listening to Stevie Ray, but I stopped studying his playing as intently as I had done previously because I got distracted doing Jimi Hendrix courses, and then I did a bunch of rhythm courses, and then I did 4 Eric Clapton courses, and I was fooling around with some Joe Bonamassa drills in the evening, and I never intentionally stopped listening to Stevie Ray Vaughan for new stuff. I just got interested in some other things. And I wasn't really aware of how much my natural instincts for what to play had changed until at some point during this pandemic, I posted a clip of me playing something and somebody commented and they said, wow, you're really, kind of developing your own style there. I was like, there's a lot of things people have called me, but original has never been one of them, and it has never really mattered to me to be original. I didn't really care. It didn't make me feel better about my own playing to be original, and it certainly didn't help my business to be original. It was just something that I looked at as some people love to feel original, so it's important for them, and there's other people whose music does better if they sound original, so it's good for them. But, you know, I was perfectly fine with the choices that I had made. So I had never consciously tried to be original. And so to hear somebody comment that was like, that's different. I've never heard that before. And then I looked at what I was playing and I was like, that doesn't sound anything like Stevie Ray Vaughan. And it was at that point that I realized in that clip, I was playing what felt natural, what was just coming off the top of my head. And almost none of it was a direct copy of something that Stevie would have played. And it was a very strange moment of revelation for me, because for 20 years, when I thought about what do I want to play more than anything else, 99% of the time, it was something from Stevie Ray Vaughan that I hadn't learned yet. And when I had that kind of moment of clarity, I thought to myself, well, what captures my attention now? And I thought of things like things that I had heard from Chris Kane, things that I had heard from a guy named Tony Vega, who is a guitar player out of Texas, whose playing I have adored for at least a decade now. When I thought about what are the sounds that I feel coming out of me now that I can't play it? Like, what do I have to teach my hands to do to equal what sounds my consciousness is trying to make? And it wasn't something from a Stevie Ray Vaughan song. And so at that moment, I kind of had to make a choice, and I had to kind of take stock of, okay, who am I and why do I do this? Because this idea that I am a guitar player whose style evolved or was based largely in Stevie Ray Vaughan, and when I play, that is the sound that captures what I'm trying to feel, that had been my primary identity as a guitar player ever since the beginning. And it wasn't something that I did for any reason other than that's who I was. That kind of playing made me feel like a person. That is what captured the feelings that I had. And now all of a sudden, I'm realizing that has shifted and I have to figure out if I'm okay with that. Because I had never had to make a decision about how I sound as a guitar player before. I had always just done exactly what I wanted to do. It just so happens that for 20 years, exactly what I wanted to do was mostly through learning stuff that Stevie played. And as I thought about it, obviously I thought about the business. I thought about, well, if I stop sounding more like Stevie Ray Vaughan, is that going to impact my business? And then I realized, well, that's stupid. I've already done courses on B.B. King and Albert King and Freddie King. And during those courses, I tried as hard as I could to sound like those players. And people love those courses. So I realized that this business is not based on me being the best at sounding like Stevie Ray Vaughan or even me being dedicated to perfecting that style. It's my ability to absorb different blues styles in the general Texas blues vein and to teach them effectively. And so I took stock of who I am and where I was, and I realized going forward, When I learn something new on guitar, it's probably not going to be something that comes from Stevie Ray Vaughan. And let me be very clear. That's not me saying that I'll never teach lessons on him again. That is not me saying I'll never teach courses on him again. And that's not even me saying that I won't try to sound more like him for a specific thing here or there. What I'm saying is that when it comes to playing for my own enjoyment, for my own therapy, for my own passion, I probably am never going to sit down and try and sound more like Stevie Ray Vaughan than I already do. There are certain things that he did that I learned from him that will always be a part of my playing. They are habits that I formed that probably will never change. But in terms of new things that I add and in terms of areas that I refine in my own playing, it's probably not going to sound more like him than it does right now. And I probably sound less like him now when I just play off the top of my head than I did maybe even 3 or 4 years ago. And so I'm going to do what I've always done, which is play exactly what I want to play. I will chase the sounds and the players that allow me to feel what I really feel through my playing. I will seek to express myself. It's just that as I've gotten older, and as I've gone through different things in life, and as I've mellowed out, the sounds that my heart and soul are trying to make don't sound as much like Stevie Ray Vaughan as they used to. And I resonate with different players playing now more than I resonate with his playing at this current moment in terms of additional things that I want to play. So the things that I've learned from him still resonate with me. It's just that the pursuit of increasing that has sort of lost its appeal to me. I don't feel the urge to adopt more of his style. And so now when I go on Instagram or wherever and I see people like Philip Sace and Matthew Scott and Tommy Katona and Wes Jeans and different players who are obviously influenced by Stevie, I obviously feel some similarity there because of where the things that we share in common, but I no longer feel the desire, not to compete, but I no longer feel the desire, like it, watching those guys play no longer feels like me, like it used to. You know, like when I first watched Stevie Ray Vaughan play, it felt like I was the one making that sound. When I watch Philip Sace do all the incredible stuff that he can do on guitar, things that I would seriously have to work hard at to get down, if I even could, it no longer is a personal pursuit for me to do that. Because my soul is not hungering to make that sound. And that's really all I can say. Yeah, I don't have any other words of wisdom for people who are seeking their own voice on guitar. My advice has always been just play like what you want to play. Play as much like the people that you want to sound like as you possibly can, but above all, be honest with yourself about what sound you really want to make. Your career may dictate that you should be more original in some cases. Or, you know, if you want to do a tribute band, your career might dictate that you sound more like a person or look like them or whatever. It's all good. The point is be aware of the decisions you're making and why you're doing it. And if you go through an extended period of time like I have where your singular desire is shaped by a specific sound, give yourself permission to change if you start to change. I always just assumed I'm just going to sound like Stevie Ray Vaughan till the day I die. Because looking around, that was the only thing that really reached inside and grabbed my attention. And so when I realized that, wow, there are other things that I hear that are having the same effect on me now as Stevie's playing did, you know, 20 some odd years ago, I had to give myself permission to be okay with that and to realize it's okay for me to do something else, because that's what I've always done, is exactly what I wanted to do. And for me to like not give myself permission to sound different would be stupid, because it violates the very reason that I started playing like him, because I wanted to, because I felt like I had to. And so I did what I wanted to do. I didn't give a damn about what anyone else said. I didn't care who criticized me for sounding like him. I didn't care if anybody thought that made me lame or whatever. For me, it felt like I had to. And so I did exactly what I wanted to do always. And now that my internal wiring has changed a little bit, or evolved or whatever, when I say evolved or grown, I don't feel like those words are right, because that implies getting better. And I don't think that I'm getting better because my tastes have changed. It's just different. If somebody wants to sound like B.B. King and only B.B. King, and they stay that way until the day they die, then there's nothing wrong with that in my eyes. If they change up and they sound more like Stevie Ray Vaughan, or they sound more like Eric Clapton, that's not better to me. That's just different. What I care about is being honest with myself. And when I change, if I'm going to remain honest, I have to be okay with the fact that who I'm going to sound like is going to be different, or it's going to get more diverse. And that is what it is. What's important is that I'm happy and I'm comfortable with it. And so that's it. That's my little talk about originality and why I'm probably not going to sound any more like Stevie Ray after 20 years of trying to. And I'm okay with that, and I hope you are too. Till next time, thanks for watching.